So, this is the CGC panel. We're all going to talk about slapping our books. Or, we can talk about Mark Waid. What do you want to do?
Slapping!
Alright, so Mark is our guest of honor, which is really appropriate considering all the years he's spent in the field, all the years he's become the Baltimore Comic-Con, the fact that he paid me to say this. It's a real opportunity to get a bunch of people who've been part of Mark's career and like to, talk him a little, talk about him a little, talk to him a little, see what's on your minds. On my left is,
he's not here.
On your street right over there.
I know, but I'll start with Christina.
Okay.
So, Christina. Tell us a little bit about yourself and your connection with the gentleman to my right.
That's me.
Very.
My name is Christina Blanche, and I met Mark 5 or so years ago at the convention, and then he followed me around, bought the house across the street from me. Just kidding. I'm paying for that.
That's how it happened.
Anyway, we're dating.
What? Sorry, ladies, I'm off the market.
There's a sigh of relief.
After I looked over at that hat, I'm thinking maybe, we can talk. I've known him for 5 years and haven't regretted one moment.
That's not true.
Hey, to my immediate left, one of his collaborators.
Yeah, my name is Dean Haspiel, and for the purpose of this panel, I drew the fox. That's all I've ever done. As co-written with Mark, and I'm trying to remember how we first met.
I was about to ask you about that as a collective.
I do remember that I had drawn a series with Evan Dorkin called Thing, Night Falls on Yancey Street, and while I was working for that editor in, I want to say, 2001 or 2 or something like that, I had come up with a pitch for Thor.
That was a great pitch.
And there you go. I got wind that Mark somehow saw it and said, that's a great pitch. I'm like, wait a second, Mark Waid, the great writer, like something that I can't, it was like a page. And he said that he would love to have maybe script that or work on that, and it just made my year. And I'll never forget that because it was really encouraging. And then I'm a big fan of his writing, and at some point we did meet, I don't know how, and I've never felt like I didn't know Mark Waid. And I've always loved his writing. So if you're looking for, Rotten Tomatoes, it ain't coming from me,
Here's my honor. Is that Q Berry?
And on my extreme right?
I'm Barry Kitson, and whatever sins I committed in a previous life. I've worked with Mark for pretty much 20-odd years.
Something like that. Yeah. Very odd, yes.
Yeah. And, we're pretty much the odd couple, but pretty much. I'm the nice one that everybody likes.
I think we've probably done more comics together than with each.
My most asked question at convention is, why do you keep working with Mark Waid?
I thought it was the assignment. Alright, so
you don't want to know how Mark and I met? It's not good enough for you?
No, you want over here? No, you don't.
You don't want to
hear that? I didn't even get to it, but go ahead.
No, please. It's all about
Mark. I want to get to the left side. Well, please, tell us your story.
To be fair, it really is all about me.
James there, then. Move along.
On my extreme left.
So how we met was...
It's okay, don't worry about me. I'm enjoying this.
So on my extreme left in the orange hat...
I introduced myself.
Would you be so kind, Mr. DeZego?
I've been so worried about my tech stuff, so everything's falling apart for me. My name is Todd DeZego. I've known Mark for way too long, as many of you have. I had a whole thing all planned. We were going to have fun. I can't show you any pictures now because it didn't work out.
No.
So pretend I'm not here. I know. This is the amazing J.G. Jones. He is far better at speaking than I, the writer, so go right ahead.
No, I can't follow that.
Give it a try.
I am probably the neophyte working with Mark Waid, so I can tell you all the dirty little details. Mark, I've known you, what, 20-something years,
yeah.
And we've never done a book together. So I actually begged him to come work on Strange Fruit with me at Boone. And it's just been a delight.
Didn't have to beg very hard, but this. So two white boys doing a book about a black guy in Mississippi. That's gone over well. Yeah.
I want to start, before you even had met Mark, can you guys recall the first time you became aware of him as a writer, either the fanzines or for comics?
I don't think Mark even was a writer before, I think.
You're taking credit for him, is that it?
Yeah. Well, Mark and I met when I was actually writing L-A-G-O-N as a book.
Yeah.
And I found as an artist, the editors pretty much left me alone, get on it, but they all thought they could write. So when I was writing it, they kept picking me up and pestering me. So Mark was actually my dialoguer originally.
That's true.
I was writing the stories, and Mark came in as dialoguer, basically to speak to the editors, so I didn't have to.
Pretty much, yes.
And that was how we became friends.
Aww.
Well,
you said you were friends.
That was before we fell out.
How about you guys?
Well, there's two points of entry for me. One is, I had heard of Mark Waid, read a lot of Mark Waid, but it wasn't honestly until Fantastic Four that it like clinched it for me. Because I felt like, it's really hard. My favorite run is the Stan Lee Jack Kirby run, which is the canon, right? And suddenly,
he's talking over me while I'm reading
like
that. That's incredible. That's pure narcissism. He'll see you later on YouTube. No, but honestly, he wrote, like, he was able to match what I felt like Lee and Kirby had done with Michael Rainbow on Fantastic Four. But the thing that made me relate to Mark Waid was often I would hear about him getting mad at something and throwing like a book against the wall. Like, he honestly had said that several times. I was like, that's my kind of guy. I know that guy. That's me.
This is probably Flash. He wrote Flash for 8 years. I'm sorry.
That's how you run. That is funny.
one of our good friends, Kyle over here, we were watching the Flash pilot together, and everyone loved it, as everyone should watch a show. And then, very seriously, he said, "Mark, have you ever written The Flash?" And the entire room got silent because we thought, is he joking? And I just went,
Kyle's defense, Kyle was like 7 years old at the time.
He's trying to kill me.
Here we go.
But,
Mark. Told so many times now, it doesn't really matter.
So it was the first Flash series.
Yeah.
Well, just for 8 years. So, yeah, sorry, Kyle.
It's all right.
Now he Googles everything before he asks.
You guys remember the first time you encountered Mark as an entity before he's a person?
Just an entity.
I mean, in my case, I was doing comic scene at Starlog, and then I moved over to DC as an assistant editor. And along the way, Mark was doing work at Amazing Heroes, and then a very short-lived Comics Weekly publication.
Yeah.
And we had hit it off, and he would then call me to talk about what was going on at DC. But it got to the point where he called so often and at such odd times, and my wife became even pesky. And then he joined DC, and we shared an office for a while together, which was a really fun time.
Yeah.
So, you know, I got to know him as a journalist first, and then as a office mate, which was a lot of fun. He didn't throw books when we were in a room together.
No,
he kept his anger until he moved around the corner.
Exactly. Yes. And I should probably add a little caveat at this point, that if you know anything about English people, if we're being polite to each other, we really don't like each other.
Oh.
The more we insult each other, any of you were the Dave Gibbons panel last year, we'll
The more we like each other, the more we insult each other. So I probably won't say anything nice about Mark during this thing.
Just to translate,
English nasty people, thing, every nasty thing I say is true.
English people are like Bizarro.
So my first physical encounter with Mark was when he'd become the dialogue on Anarchy Lao and the book I had been working on for 2 years, writing and drawing it.
I know where the story's going.
Yeah. We're at a meeting to do a crossover between three or four books, and within 5 minutes, Mark was going, "That's not happening in my book." It's his book already.
That's not quite what I meant, but yes.
So, Mark has made his mark at. Started as an assistant editor, and he really, at DC, made his presence felt in the types of stuff he did, notably things like Legion, and then also in Secret Origins, where he got a chance to show us where his taste ran and his interest, and he did some really goofy stuff. Could you tell when Mark was editing a book? Was there something you guys noticed about what he brought to a title? Anything at all?
I'm not that old.
Oh, oh, don't boo. Oh, don't.
Yeah. He would give you the origins or, from all sorts of obscure, fun characters right up the Caps Hobbies hits.
Yeah. Yes, exactly.
So, I would argue that what Mark does, and if you had to boil down one word, is authenticity.
Okay.
He keeps, he respects the source material. You might add new wrinkles or do a twist on it, but it's always done with love and homage versus, oh, I know how to tear it apart and make it mine. Yeah. He still makes it his by keeping it yours, if that makes sense.
Like anybody can do that. That's the easiest thing to write. My joke about Archie Comics was that anyone could write page one, panel one, Jughead has a heroin needle sticking out of his arm. We'd get headlines, and yes, people with hipsters would go, oh, that's edgy and cool, I'm gonna read that. But that's stupid. That's not any moron can write that. You've got to dig down, figure out what the characters are, what you love about the characters, and then just show people why I love them. That's the job. It's like I just more of a conduit. I liken it to being a geologist. I go, or a gem maker. Just go in and polish up the stuff.
I would even say custodian. I know that word is kind of weird, but he's a great custodian of these characters we love.
I've never met anybody loves these characters more than Mark does. He loves them and he respects them. And I know, and as a reader and as a retailer, I know, and it's, yeah, there might be a little bias, but if a Mark Waid book comes out, I know it's going to be good and it's going to be respectful, and I know that I can sell that book and I'm going to read that book. In fact, I wouldn't let him talk to me about Daredevil because I loved the Daredevil book so much. That was like, I couldn't wait for that book to come in. I didn't want any surprise.
Mark wrote Daredevil?
Kyle?
In fact, that's interesting you say that because I've heard Mark say that he didn't even know what was going to happen in the next issue because he kept it on a cliffhanger moment.
That's true.
That you wouldn't, you'd have to write yourself out of
that. Literally,
to keep it interesting.
That is still how I write cliffhangers. I've been doing it my entire career. Is that when I put them in a horrible situation on page 20 and you don't know what's happening, I don't know either. That's part of the fun of it. For the first 10 years I did it, I thought, I'm screwing this up, I'm doing it wrong, what's wrong with me? And after about 15 years, I thought, you know what? This apparently is my method. Yeah. So I figured if I don't know, you can't guess, and we'll both be surprised.
Yeah.
There was one time when you wrote yourself into a corner, and it was a tough couple weeks because you couldn't figure it out. And he was the grumpiest.
I was,
I want to talk about throwing books. But he was like, I've done it. There's no way I can get out of this. I don't know. And it was a tough 2 weeks. And then all of a sudden, he was like, oh, yeah, I got it.
Which one?
Comic, come on.
It was a Daredevil.
I'm trying to remember which one it was. It was early on in the second run.
He was falling really off a cliff or something.
It was the answer that it was all a dream.
All right, so JJ, since you were the most recent collaborator and you've been waiting for this opportunity, what is it about Mark's stuff that's made you want to work with him?
It's really humiliating in a way, being up here on the, not humiliating, but embarrassing. That's the word I'm like, being up here on the panel, like I'm dead. but in advance, thank you for all the kind things you're saying. Now, go on.
You being dead was how my whole presentation was going to go. But none of it's working. And it's my fault. It's not these guys' fault. I am technologically impaired. So I apologize. But it was a whole thing about how great you were and how we're going to miss you. And all the stuff you did, the times we did crazy things together. Because we've had personal moments. Not like that. Mark and I met 20 years ago.
Yes.
At a Marvel conference when they were trying to get the Heroes Reborn to come back together. And they got all us writers together and said, we screwed up, how do we fix this? And Mark and I had met briefly once before that, but Mark was then writing, I tell this story every time we're together. He was writing the X-Men while Scott Lobdell, who was a longtime friend of mine, was writing Uncanny X-Men, and of course, driving everyone out of their minds, because he is obnoxious. I can say it, I tell it to his face. But at Marvel, the room was full of writers, and a few artists were there, and they had given us those guns in the 70s, in the 90s, that were the Star Trek, you put batteries in them and they shot the foam discs.
Right.
And everybody's running around shooting. It was one of those things they give you to try to relax during a really tense brainstorming session. It was a big room, just like this. And Scott was running around stealing everybody's little discs because he wanted to have everything on him. And I turned to Mark and I said, you know, if we put a silver dollar in this, it would go through his brain like a hot dog. Mark grabbed me and he said, you are my best friend. And it has been that way ever since then. We've had some crazy times, we've done some goofy things.
Well, you collaborated with him on Kazar, right?
We did do a Kazar story. That's
so
right.
So what's it like collaborating with him, writer to writer?
I think, have you collaborated with him before?
just in the office.
Because it was on that one. Well, I'll throw you under the bus on this one because you did say, hey, do you want to co-write this with me? And I said, yeah, sure, that sounds great. Good, here's the story. Kazar meets his brother. See you later.
I'm out. See you.
Stan Lee style.
In his defense, Mark was writing like 5 books for Marvel and maybe one sneakily still for DC.
Yeah.
And he was going to be taking over Kazar. They were doing that big flashback project. And they said to Mark, you've got to write the Kazar. And he was like, no interest, or he said, here you go, let's go. So yeah, we did that. That was fine. That was a lot of fun. Yeah. And it was John Cassaday's first work and he would not talk to me now at all.
Wow. Yeah.
Just the way he is. He must have hated that story.
So JG, can you elaborate on the answer you never quite gave us before?
I'm sorry.
No.
No, what about Mark's stuff, you know, has made you want to work with him?
Mark was one. I didn't read comics. I know this is heresy, but I didn't read comics for years. I dropped out of the scene and just got back into it when I was well into my late 20s, 30s.
You look 14.
Mark was one of the first guys whose stuff I read regularly.
Thank you.
And I've been really lucky in this business where after I got over that initial hump of working for like Crusade and Diamond, some other companies, I finally got some decent gigs, and I've been able to choose the people I want to work with for about the last 15 years. And Mark has been on my get list forever because I just love his writing. And, you know, I brought him a little project and begged him to jump in with me.
I'm begging.
So, is it true he writes it in blackface?
Oh!
Yay! Yay, everybody!
And we're out! See you later, folks! That's
very
quick. It's all Mark.
No. that's how we started. I've worked with Mark, writer to writer. You know, you've been writing the Legion book and then collaborating with him on the Legion book and then subsequently done your own one. Are there things you learned from him as a writer?
No. I told him everything he knows.
Exactly, yes.
No, I mean, in all seriousness, and I've said this to Mark, actually to him, which is ridiculous, because I almost never say anything nice to anyone.
That's true.
I've been thinking about retiring if I wasn't still working with Mark.
Oh.
It's more fun working with Mark than anyone else I've ever worked with.
Oh, that's nice.
You know, I've said that to you.
I know, but I'm still saying it. I can't say, yeah, you're right.
We collaborate more than, you know, I don't think anybody collaborates quite as much as we do when we work together.
No,
this is complete back and forth.
It is complete back and forth all the time, exactly. As it should be. It's,
you know, do you want to counter that? Is it complete back and forth with...
No, it totally is. I think these two talk more than Mark and I talk. But I'm not jealous.
No. if it's any consolation, he does tell me he loves you more. And that's why I was thinking of retirement.
I would be okay if you...
I mean, the other great thing about Mark is everything is genuinely about the story.
Yeah.
The story, as good as it can be. And, we've worked on stories where, you know, Mark's run me and said, I know what we've got to do. We've got to kill this character. And I was like, but we really like her.
Yeah.
Yeah, but she has to die for the story.
Yeah.
And that kind of makes it special because you know it's about the story. It's not about, for Mark, and hopefully, you know, it's not about showing off for others. It's about making good comics, and that's the most important thing.
That's what it's all about. And again, my feeling is very strongly that when I write something, it's not my story the moment I hand it over to an artist, the moment we start collaborating on something. It's our story. You know, it's not, I'm not a precious little orchid hothouse flower that has to see everything that he puts on paper be exactly the way that I saw in my head. It's a collaboration. So, and you get much better work out of it. I get much better work because I'm working with Barry. I get much better work because I'm working with these guys. I get, you know, much better work with everybody I work with because I'm lucky, like JG, I'm lucky enough to be able to, at this point, kind of pick the guys I want to work with. And I'm smart enough to hire people better than I am. So.
But then this is another true thing about Mark, which, again, proves that it's about the story and it's about the comic. It's quite often we discuss scenes we've discussed dialogue, and usually I send Mark the finished art before he dialogues. And quite often, you know, when I see it, the dialogue's all gone. You know, a lot of writers will put the dialogue in because, you know, they've got these great phrases and things they want to say. But Mark will just say, "Now you did it with the picture, we don't need the dialogue anymore." You know, that's a big compliment you can get from a writer.
Also,
geez, you're right. Yeah, this is another story I do have to tell you.
Oh, okay.
My favorite plot I ever got from Mark.
Yeah.
Remember the one?
No.
It says pages 5 to 17.
Yes.
They fight.
Yep.
Another X number of $1,000 for me.
It was a good day. Went to the movies at 2:00 in the afternoon.
Now, Dean, the Fox is a different type of book for you.
Yes, yes.
And tonality is a different sort of book for you.
Yeah.
So what is it you're both bringing to this project, and how are you working on it together?
Well, I'm mostly known for drawing comics. In fact, mostly known for drawing memoir-type comics, like working with Harvey Pekar, Jonathan Ames, Inferno Lopez. I've done my own. But I've always loved superhero comics. I've always wanted to do superhero comics. But I just never was good enough for prime time, or at least according to the editors, I think. And so I had this opportunity to write and draw a six-page Fox story that was going to be a backup. And when I did, I handed it in. The editor at the time, Archie/Red Circle, now Dark Circle, said, "Oh, that's really great. What about a 5-issue miniseries?" And I was like, "What?" And I've always liked the Fox, and I was a big fan of Alex, the two stories Alex Toth did, and I knew the first rule was to never do anything like he did, because there's no way I could compete with that. So I kind of had this other story idea that I brushed off and kind of retooled it, and I pitched it, and it flew. And I've been talking to Mark for many, many years about wanting to collaborate. I've been writing emails. Half the time I'd read a Daredevil or Fantastic Four or anything you've been writing. And I'd get an email saying how much I liked it, and he wrote me back, and then we just had this nice parlay.
He writes you back?
He writes me back. That's right. And I thought, like, on the one hand, maybe this is a way we could collaborate. Like, if I wrote this plot, and he read it and sanctioned it and thought it was good enough and then could add the dialogue to it, that would be a great way to work. And does everyone know the old Marvel method is in that way, where the artist basically kind of concocts a story, or at least, you know, Jack Kirby, Steve Ditko would kind of go home and, you know, maybe with a loose idea, draw 20 pages with notes in the panels and stuff like that, and then Stanley would dialogue it, and there'd be some great collaboration. So it was kind of done in the spirit of that. The thing is, though, I would like write out this plot, talk to Mark a little bit about it, talk to the editor, it would get approved, I'd go draw it, send him the artwork with the plot, with maybe some ideas for some dialogue, or at least to show the intent of the character. And then, like, shortly thereafter, we get this dialogue that was like a master class in writing. It was amazing just to read that and to go, wait a second, I'm working with this guy, one of my heroes? And it really was, I don't know how you felt working that way. I don't know if you've worked in that style before. I assume you have.
It's pretty much how we work.
That's how you guys?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
But more so with you, and this has been a fun experiment and actually shows how in sync we are, is that, especially with the last two or three plots, I didn't even read them. I would just get, I'd get your artwork, and I'd have a plot.
Right.
And I'd think, you know what?
Don't need it.
Let me see, and I would do the whole dialogue, and then I would go back onto the plot and go, oh, yeah, this is exactly what this is exactly what you intend. I sort of did it as a fun exercise on my end, but again, that it reflected the story you wanted to tell.
Right.
So we were very much in sync.
We were in sync in that way, and we both wanted to honor a certain kind of comic book that's not really being told as much these days. And I felt like he was also the glue. Mark was the glue. If I was veering off in a direction that was a little wonky, which I tend to do, he would somehow make it work in the dialogue. So we had this nice tension, I guess, between visual and text. I would love to one day actually draw a Mark Waid script, if anybody understands what I mean by that word. He just concocted it. Thought about what, you know, my virtues were, and wrote an actual story for me to draw. I'd love to get some
moose. We're the moose. We'll do moose at Archie.
Oh, we were thinking about doing moose at Archie.
I'll figure out.
I would love to do that. Okay, thank you.
Yeah. So I'll just say this: this whole thing has kind of turned into about the craft and how to work with Mark Waid. And I really thought this was going to be more of a roast. I have been asked to do a roast of Mark Waid. Actually, 15 years ago, we did one out in Ohio, and they wanted to get him, and I brought a puppet. It was a Mark Waid puppet. And everybody seemed to like that, and I didn't want to do that again. But I thought there would be a podium.
Oh, I thought the puppet was on your other hand. There was a
disappointment. Oh, you wanted me to. Oh, no. No, the puppet, actually, in respect that for you, I burned the puppet. You kept rolling your eyes. You said it looked like Bunsen Honeydew. I'm sorry.
As I recall, you took an orange Nerf ball and cut it in half.
And I put glasses on.
Yeah, exactly.
I bought a cool like Cabbage Patch doll coat or something. It looked good, but you didn't like it, so I got rid of it because I love you that much.
So Todd, are you saying you had some prepared remarks you
had
to share?
I had lots of prepared stuff, and I had video, and I'm a little heartbroken because my friend Rich Woodall did some beautiful Photoshop stuff that was going to be exactly that. I thought there'd be a podium, a chance for me to kind of poke fun at Mark, but I don't like roasts. I don't like watching him on TV. I don't like people to. I know a lot of dirt on him, but I'm not sharing it with you guys. I'm saving it for when I need money. So instead of doing that, I once again tried to come up with a creative way to be able to play with him. So my friend Rich Woodall helped me do some very fun Photoshop effects that sadly we can't see, but I did have some stuff prepared, and I'd like to read it if I could.
Please.
I hope that you all bear with me, and maybe I can describe what the pictures would be, and that'll be a lot of fun. No, I have a good voice. So it did start out with, and if anybody has any questions during this, save them for later. Friends, we have come here to bury Mark Waid, not to praise him. I already blew that before. What can I say about Mark Waid that hasn't already been so eloquently voiced by this incredibly distinguished, incredibly talented panel? and Barry. and here we are celebrating 50 years in 30 years in comics. 30 years. A writer has entertained us with some of the greatest comic stories of the past 10 years. Could we call him the greatest comic book writer of all time? No. No, we couldn't. Could we call him the greatest living comic book writer? Again, no. Because Stan's still alive. But soon. I swear to God, I have you all on videotape. If that gets back to Stan, I won't come. Any of you. He has thrilled us with his magnificent work on Flash, Fantastic Four, Kingdom Come, Irredeemable, Irresistible, Irresponsible, whatever the hell. The Justice League, Daredevil, and what's the one you guys do, Barry?
I'm not talking to you anymore.
Okay, so you threw me all off now, thanks.
Empire, it's based on the Fox show.
No, yeah. The good one, Legion of Superheroes. Oh,
that was the setup.
Yeah. Come with me, Barry Kitson. You're my brother.
I used to like him.
Mark and I have been friends for the past 20 years, and as the story goes, we bonded immediately, sharing a side, I already told this story, sharing a similar background, a similar sensitivity, a similar passion for comics, and a similar all-consuming obsession with a fellow comic book professional that most both loathed and reviled.
It's not about me, Todd.
Not you. This is something else. Anyway. But over the years, I have come to know a different Mark Waid than you know. The world knows Mark Waid, the storyteller, the craftsman, the writer who has dynamically and lovingly taken our favorite four-colored characters to the edge of the earth and beyond. You know him as the incredible encyclopedia of comic book knowledge, the man who, at the drop of a hat, can tell you what was the issue number of the Brave and the Bold story that featured the Atom manipulating Batman's brain?
115.
Who drew the cover of the classic Spider-Man No More issue?
Oh, John Reader.
Who drew the Archie Comics newspaper strip through the 1960s?
Harry Lucy.
But what does he know of real world questions? The hard questions in life are the ones that matter. What is the sound of one game classic?
Where's the piece of the buddy into Todd's?
Where are my keys?
Which is the correct way to hang the toilet paper?
I'm just gonna talk over in my head after talking. Mark can also tell you what comic it is by the adverts on the back of the costume. There's a picture of me about 6 years old I showed him, and I'm reading the comic. And he said, oh, that's so. I was like, how do you know that? Oh, that was the advert on the back of that one. Sorry, Todd.
No, it's
very good.
I love you.
I know
Mark, the man, a kindred spirit, and was his pal and wingman during a time in our lives when we realized how lonely we were and how the job he had chosen, or rather had chosen us, was a life of quiet solitude. Sure, the comics game seems like one of exotic travel and exciting parties, but it is not. It is a life of isolation as we sit in our offices or studios, a life that stifles any possibility of socializing, of meeting new people, and yes, new ladies. I can recall a time when Mark and I were both down in the dumps and over the state of our social lives, and for months prior to meeting up at one convention or another, I don't know where it was, we made a pact, a solemn vow, that we would climb out of our nerdy shells, that we would cheer the other one on, and that we would each be each other's wingman and meet some women outside of the comics convention scene. We were, after all, smart, attractive, and in many ways charming guys who deserved to find happiness. We set out and landed in a small karaoke bar. Both of us have lovely singing voices. We do. We do. We do.
Gotta prove it.
Later at the karaoke. And with confidence and support from one another, sure enough, we soon found ourselves chatting with two stunning blondes who saw us not as the shy, retiring geeks that we were, but as the cool, self-assured guys we knew we could be. It was a huge surprise, of course, later when the one that Mark was with turned out to be this huge Legion of Superheroes fan. And they talked all night, and I hit mine. I guess that didn't go over very well. I have, of course, been delighted to see Mark finally find the happiness he deserved. There were great pictures here. I found them on the net. They weren't those kind of pictures. Well, I don't have anything in my house or anything like that. The woman in the streets is very... his very lovely partner in crime, Christine. They share a very happy life together in Indiana or Illinois?
Indiana.
Okay. They own a comic shop that I have not been invited to. And all his dreams have come true. We have all watched Mark become a better and better storyteller over the years. We have seen him succeed and triumph with each and every project that he has taken on. But we live in a different world these days. Scientists have now stated that many of them believe in many different worlds, a multitude of realities. Some might even call them infinite Earths. Nice job, science. We've only been talking about that for the last 40 years. Glad you got on. There are worlds where even the smallest details are changed and everything is different. So while Mark Waid is famous and celebrated and honored here today in this room, I can't help but wonder if Mark Waid would have fared so well had he had been so successful, if he was in fact, and you really got to see these pictures, a ferret. Would Mark Waid the ferret have had it so easy? Would Mark Waid the ferret have been faced with the obstacles that our Mark Waid never had? Can a ferret even type? Would Mark Waid the ferret have been able to fight through the challenges that come with being a ferret comic book writer in a man's world? Would he even have been hired by an assistant editor at DC? Would he have been able to make the move from editorial to writing in the same way? Brian Augustin probably doesn't even like ferrets. But you know what? I like to think that Mark Waid the ferret would be able to fight the insensitive leers, the nasty looks and discriminations, that he would triumph there as much as he did here. I believe that he would still find happiness and love, although I also think that that world's Christine would have a bit of explaining to do. I believe that Mark Waid the ferret would be the greatest ferret comic book writer there ever was. And I believe that he would still be my very good friend. And there's a picture of me hugging a ferret. There's a picture of you hugging a ferret.
You know, in the UK they have competitions for how long people can keep ferrets and their trouser legs.
Yeah.
I'm not sure if you do that in the States, but I found that all lasted very soon.
Mark, you have worked with these science people.
Yes.
Until now.
There are also pretty many others. You know, Pete Krause, Mike Borrego, yeah. And Chris Samuel. These days, it's been mentioned, you know, you get pretty much the ability to pick and choose who you get to work with. So what do you look for in a collaborator these days?
Somebody who puts story first. Like, seriously, that's it. Like, somebody who draws just nothing but splash pages and wants to make a cool shot and wants to sell artwork after the fact and stuff. That doesn't interest me. I mean, I want to be with somebody. And also somebody who has, like, an ethical and moral center. Because there is, I feel very strongly that what we do should have some sense of hope to it. It doesn't mean it has to be simple, it doesn't mean it has to be childlike, it doesn't have to be unsophisticated, but I don't write cynical, you know? Because it's, first off, it's really easy. And secondly, I don't feel that way. I don't feel, you know, I get skeptical. There's a difference. The skeptic and the cynic are two different people. You know, skeptic can be concerned about the future or not believing in everything, but a cynic is just, you know, that's just a dark road to go. I don't want to be a cynic, and it's not my work. It's never been my work. Even with Irredeemable, there was always a core of hope to it. And so that's what I look for, is people who want to tell those same kinds of stories. And
you've been reading that line?
Yeah. there's some hope. Yeah, right, there's some hope in it. It's my offense. But yeah, but still, even then, there are some, even then you still root for somebody in that book.
Yeah.
That's what I look for. Moving on.
All right, so, Mark, you've been an editor.
Yeah.
You've been a reporter, writer.
All right.
Webmaster, publisher, and now retailer.
Yes.
Is there a preference?
Actually, seriously, editor.
Okay.
That's my favorite job. That's what I want. I didn't want to be a writer growing up. I really didn't. I expected maybe I would do some writing, but it never occurred to me that I could do this on a regular basis and come up with stories every week. And so I just wanted to be an editor. That or a radio announcer. That was my fallback as a radio announcer. But the fun part of being an editor is helping other people tell their stories. And what I found, especially when I was working at Boom as an editor about 6 or 7 years ago, is that by sitting down and having to articulate to a younger writer what it is I'm looking for in a story or why I think you could have made a better choice here or there, it forced me to put into words stuff that I just find that I did instinctively. And in doing so, it made me question my choices in a good way. It made me sort of examine the tools in my toolbox rather than just take them completely for granted, if that makes any sense.
So, well, in some ways, leaving DC staff when you did opened up the door to your writing career.
Yeah.
But do you regret, you know, the actions that led up to that moment?
Yes. But the specific actions, yes. But in general, no. I mean, in general, it's worked out really well. There is, you know, I actually thought that was my end of career in comics when I left DC Comics, but it turned out to have been the best thing that could have happened. So, yeah. But
you see yourself going back at editing at some point?
I'm actually doing a little bit of that now. I'm actually doing a little cyborg for a video game company. And not how. I know, in my spare time. And instead of writing for them, what they sort of asked me to do is they want to do some more like internal like digital comics and stuff like that. I said, you care how much they cost to do? No. I said, you care how much money they make? They said, no. I said, well, I am the expert at making digital comics that you have no idea that they're not going to make any money. So please. And so I'm working with those guys. And sort of did a boot camp for about 2 weeks, right? We took them from start to finish about what a comic book is, how you put it together, how you create this thing. And you know, here's Comics 101, which is this is panels, this is pages, this is captions. Here's Comics 201, which is, you know, here's what a story is, here's the things you have to look out for when you do a story, here's the stuff that makes a terrible story. The 301 is no more than 35 words in a balloon, no more than, you know, 35 words in a panel, whatever. Sort of rules of thumb. And so doing that put me in a position where now I'm on retainer with them and I'm doing editorial work with them. I'm not having to write, but I'm able to it's just, it, again, like I said, it's the same skill set, but you're coming at it from a completely different angle. And it's very rewarding. I like TV. You know, think of it, everybody in the creative industry that I know of, when they get to a certain point in their career, they all say the same thing, which is, I really like teaching. And there's something about being in a position where you realize that, again, it being able to pass what you learn on to other people allows you to learn this at the same time. Yeah.
Can you imagine being a showrunner for the TV?
Yeah.
That's kind of what you described.
Yeah, that's exactly, and I could totally do that. I know how to work a room. Yeah. You know, I know how to, because the first rule of working a room when you're working with different writers and that kind of stuff is it's improv, right?
Yep.
And so, The rule of improv is never say no. Mm-hmm. The rule of improv is always say yes and, mm-hmm. you know, and let other people feed off each other's ideas. And that's how I run a room. And I love doing that stuff. Yeah. Do you know of anything? Because I got some time.
I want to throw this open to questions, but first, is there any deep, dark Mark Waid secret you're willing to share on this panel?
No, so let's open it up.
he actually does have a good singing voice. I could get him to, you know, play rock band. And I also would like to let everybody know that he is up for Best Writer tonight.
Again?
Savory loss of Ryan Vaughn, please. Okay? We call them the Saga Awards. Okay.
Yes, but he is up for it.
He
is up for it, and I voted for him. And you also edited my book, Charlie Merlin.
I do.
And he is an excellent editor.
Thank you.
And I appreciate it. And we collaborate okay on that sometimes.
Obviously, all the times he sleeps in the other room.
That's actually true. He will sleep across the house.
I'm up here as the great and the Vaseline of this panel, obviously. But Mark and I, I guess we're about two different people can get. I am the cynical, nasty, dark person that Mark doesn't ever be.
You're also really cheap.
We've had our ups and downs probably more than anybody else over here. But the one thing, he threw me out of his house when I was staying with him in New York.
Moving on.
Yeah. But whatever happens, whatever Mark does, I've always said to anybody, no matter how much I may disagree with you on something or whatever, you always do what you honestly believe is the right thing to do. And that kind of,
Was it right of him to throw you out of the house?
Well, he realized it was a mistake later. He's a big enough man to do it.
They seriously are the odd couple.
That's true.
The fact that, I would defend him even if I think he's doing the wrong thing, because I know he's doing it for the right reasons.
You will continue to do that, probably. So,
I've got stitches.
Also, during a time when I think people are afraid to say certain things in public, Mark still has his voice, and he's very respectful, but I believe, even if he'll make mistakes in public, and then he'll even apologize if he's made a mistake, or if he feels something's wrong, or he learned something different. And I always find that completely refreshing. To remain in public in that way, because a lot of people just skitter away. I mean, even I sometimes wonder if I should enter on a comment or something, because am I prepared to deal with this for the next 3 days? I don't know. And I always find that it's very honorable. And even when you disagree, or even when Mark feels like, oh, I think I was wrong, he'll come out and say that, and I think that's really refreshing.
I will also come out and say when you were wrong.
Yes, that's true.
No. Follow him on Twitter, Mark Waid, if you want to be entertained.
Or Outrage, one of the two.
Actually, two questions for Mr. Waid.
Sure.
One, now that you kind of raised the point, you're not a cynic.
Yeah.
Is it in your mind now to challenge yourself by writing a character who is a cynic to work outside of yourself? And my second question, sir.
Yes.
When may I expect my near-mint Daredevil replacements?
Soon. And that's a good question. It hadn't occurred to me until now, but that's not a bad way to go, sort of working outside my comfort zone. That's a really dark place to go for me, but that's not a bad idea.
Well, you've written characters that are African American and you're not. You've written characters that are aliens and you're not. Says you brought the tears to my eye while reading Daredevil. I would like my collection.
All right, well,
sir.
Yes.
First of all,
Chris, after you.
Christine from the other Murdoch papers asked me to say hello to you.
Oh, yeah, she's awesome. Great, thanks.
Secondly, this is just my own feeling, but I get the sense that there might have been more you wanted to do with Matt Murdoch in San Francisco rather than ending with issue 18, and I'm just curious if that was the case.
There's a little more we could have done. There's a couple of stories that I knew I wanted to tell, getting you the chance to tell, but Chris Omni just said, look, I've been doing it for 3 years. I've run out of ways to draw radar sense. And I respect that wholeheartedly. I mean, this is the reason I left Fantastic Four, because Mike just said, I've run out of Fantastic Four stories to tell, so let's go do something else, which is fine. That's fine. There's no point in continuing on. I didn't want to work with it. Just as I didn't want to do any more FF without Mike. I didn't want to do any more Daredevil without Chris. So that's a small sacrifice to say, no, there's still, we're you know, I'm only a third of my way through my career. So there's still plenty of time to go back and do that. Thank you.
Fair enough.
Alien.
Yes, sir.
Is there any chance or plans to return to the Irredeemable universe, any of those characters, either before the Plutonian snapped or at the end of the series?
Well, there's a, I guess just throw it a chance. There's no plans. I mean, there's no, I don't want to do, I have no interest in doing the Irredeemable stuff before Plutonian snaps, because that's what makes them interesting to me. That's that sort of weirdly autobiographical, sort of sketchy, sort of emotionally damaged guy. That's interesting to me. After that, again, I think that kind of, that story's kind of done, but I wouldn't be averse to trying to find some way to do something in that universe. But thank you for asking. You know, not really. The closest answer I have, and again, not to, you know, not to lean on Mike too much, but Captain Marvel, DC's Captain Marvel, would have been a really good one. And Mike and I had, you know, Mike Ringo and I had a pitch, and Mike did a beautiful piece, and we really wanted to do it. And with Mike gone, I don't really want to go there anymore. I mean, that might be the answer. All right, but so that I don't end on a really somber note, I've also never done a Batman story, really. I did like a one-shot Batman in Barcelona or whatever, and I've done a lot of Batman in Justice League, and I've done this and that, but I've never done like any sort of extended Batman run. That might be fun to do someday, because it's weird that that's one of the great characters in comics, and yet that's, having done everything, and I stopped counting at 2,000 comics a few years ago. So I don't know, but it's funny that none of them are Batman.
You said that you're at the point in your career now where you can basically pick and choose your collaborators. Is there anybody coming up on your radar that you're looking towards to working with?
I met Doc Shaner a little while ago. He's doing S.H.I.E.L.D. that comes out next week. And that was my big get for the year, because I love Doc Shaner stuff. There's a couple other guys, but I'm not going to tell you because you might take them from me. So.
What's the first comic you read that made you love comics?
That's it. There are two. There are the first one I read that made me love comics is Batman 180. It was the first issue I got after the TV show started. This is 1966, and it was the first comic I ever read, so that counts. But there's an issue of Action Comics number 500 that. There's three answers. I'm going to keep going. That comes from 500, which is the life story of Superman. And it was written by Marty Pascoe and Tom Baker's one. And it was the first time I really got a sense that the writer was writing from the inside of the character. Like, there's moments in that book that Marty is clearly writing about Superman in a very personal way. He's having Superman explain what it's like to be Superman. In a stupid, sort of over-the-top way, but he's talking about when he was a boy and he had a dog that came from Krypton. He said that was the greatest day of his life because suddenly he wasn't alone anymore. And what it was like to have somebody fly by your side who knew what it felt like when the wind ran across your face, or knew the sound that bullets made when they bounced off living flesh. And I loved it. I saw that. I had that page. I found that page on eBay years ago, that comic. And that, as much as anything, made me love comics, because really saw for the first time how you could put yourself in these, and really dig into these characters and get an emotional core of them that before then was all plot, with a like clever, cool gimmick in a story or clever plot. But this is about that. All right, I got one more. Do we have time for one more?
Yeah.
It, my favorite Superman story of all time. I'm gonna try to tell us without choking up. So. It sounds ridiculous when I tell you that the story is about, it's called Superman Owes $1 Billion. But the story, it's never, I want to preface this by reminding you, Superman stories today were told for 8-year-old boys. I mean, there was no sophistication. It was all suspension of disbelief. It was all whimsy. The story doesn't have to make any realistic sense. But the story is about an IRS agent who realizes it, because even though Superman does all these things for charity, when he makes diamonds out of coal, or when he finds gold mines for or donates to orphanages and stuff, that it's off of that, that it's still taxable income. And so he decides, well, yes, so but Superman has done, you know, generated billions and billions of dollars for charity, but Superman still technically owes the United States government, IRS, $1 billion in back taxes. So he calls Superman in, and Superman, who has a long, long history of trying to honor incredibly flimsy contracts, which is every third Superman story, says, all right, well, I'll try to pony up. So he sends the entire issue, like, trying to dig down to Atlantis to find this ancient artifact, and then realizes, oh my god, the rays from the scepter can heal this weird disease and stuff, so I've got to give it over to a hospital. Or he'll go in space, he'll find these super gem minerals or whatever, and then he realizes they belong to somebody else who's getting them. So this is the whole story, like, just, you know, comedy of errors. Like, I got the $1 billion, oh crap, I got to give it away. So the end of the story is Superman shows up and says, I got nothing. And the guy's boss comes in, the IRS agent's boss comes in, and he says, it's kind of stupid, but he says, this is ridiculous. Look, if you want to go by the letter of the law, by the IRS code, this is ridiculous. Why am I getting so horrible? By the IRS code, everybody gets deductions for their dependents, right? Everybody's like, at that time, it was like $300 on your extension. The whole world depends on Superman. And I can't believe this is getting me. But that, as goofy as that was, like the setup of that, the punchline of that, just meant the world to me. Like, this is a character. When I was a kid, I didn't have a whole lot of, like, parental support and stuff, and I didn't feel like I was particularly, cared about it, whatever, but, and that's also what I saw in the Superman movie, is like, this is a character who cares about everybody. That's awesome. What a great superpower that you can have anything and do anything, and you can take anything you wanted and said, you use those powers to make the world a better place and to do for other people. That made me love comics as much as anything. Oh my god, this is humiliating.
Mark's got a panel next door. Then he'll be at the table later. By all means, pay your respects there. Thanks for your time and attention.